folks. It's good to be with you.
Amen.
Amen. Shall we pray? I look unto the hills, where does my help come from? The Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Almighty God, as we bow before you today, we acknowledge your greatness and your majesty. We humbly confess every sin, and acknowledge your sovereignty and glory today. You are the everlasting God. You are the great I Am. We give you the glory and we give you the praise that man is nothing, but you are everything. You deserve glory and praise and honor. And so, Father, we pray in the name of our blessed Lord Jesus Christ, the Lamb that was shed for us, the Lamb that shed his blood for us, the Lamb where the angels are worshipping him. Worthy, worthy is the Lamb that was slain. We bow before you, O God, and in the name of thy Son, we ask for blessings in Jesus' name. May the anointing of thy Holy Spirit, for God the Holy Spirit created the world, and without him we can do nothing, and we pray that the Holy Spirit would open our hearts and show us and reveal us things from your word. Bless every family here today, Lord. Whoever is struggling today, may they know your love. May they know your comfort. May they know your peace. May they know your joy. And Lord, I pray each heart here today may leave saying, it is good to be in the house of the Lord. Bless them, Lord, for they are your people. Strengthen them, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. If you'd like to turn to Isaiah 45, we're looking at the whole chapter, but I'm learning from Pastor Kim. We're not going to read it all. I'll read a few verses, but if you can get it on computer here, I don't know if you can, Praveen. Is that too much? Or yeah? When I'm going through it, Praveen can put it up here and you can read it if you want to follow it. I'll just read a few verses. This is what the Lord says to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I take hold of, to subdue nations before him and to strip kings of their armor, to open doors before him so that gates will not be shut. I will go before you and I will level the mountains. I will break down gates of bronze and cut through bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness, riches stored in secret places, so that you may know that I am the Lord, the God of Israel, who summoned you by name. For the sake of Jacob, my servant of Israel, my chosen. The title of the sermon, so that you could go away and think about it, is called God is Over Our Secular Nation. God is over our secular nation. For the last 20 years, especially, secularism, the anti-God spirit, has been growing stronger and stronger in this land. And it's reached a crescendo today where we've made many laws that attack the word of God, like abortion, gay marriage, and all the rest of it. And there is this strong oppression coming upon God's people in our land because of secularism. And maybe you felt it at work or at college. Wherever you go today, there is an anti-God spirit. And it is aggressive in its nature. If you're a father or mother trying to bring up your child at school, the pressures of school. If you're at college, the pressures of college. If you're at work, for example, if you're a nurse, You're not allowed to wear a cross at the hospital. So, number one, God is over the secular realm. God is over the secular realm. Just to... Is there any chance just that someone might get me a glass of water? If that's okay, I'm sorry about this, because I get very thirsty. In some churches, they call me Two Jugs Jay. I drink two jugs of water when I preach. Okay. In 2013, Nadia Udin, a Christian working for British Airways, had to appeal to the European Court of Human Rights to win a 6-year legal battle after being placed on unpaid leave for wearing a small cross round her neck at work. In 2015, a prominent Northern Ireland pastor was prosecuted for a sermon also published online which he strongly rejected the Islamic doctrine that Jesus was a Muslim. In 2015, the government proposed imposing government registration and inspection of Sunday schools, something the UK abolished more than two centuries ago. In 2016, a student who had fled persecution in Africa was thrown off a university social work course in the UK because of a Facebook post affirming traditional Christian view of marriage. And in 2017, a Crown Prosecution Service lawyer claimed that publicly quoting parts of the King James Bible in modern Britain should be considered. Thank you. In 2017, a Crown Prosecution Service lawyer claimed that publicly quoting parts of the King James Bible in modern Britain should be considered to be abusive and is a criminal matter. So quoting the King James Bible is seen by some in the courts as a criminal matter. But God is over the secular realm. Even though our free speech is being taken away, God is still over this land. You see, in verse 1 it says, "This is what the Lord says to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I take hold of, to subdue nations before him, and to strip kings of their armor, to open doors before him, so the gates will not be shut." Who is Cyrus? Cyrus had not existed then. Cyrus was not alive then. But God is saying, in 200 years' time, a guy called Cyrus is going to come along, a secular guy, and I'm going to use this secular king to take my people out of Persia so that they can go back to Jerusalem and build the temple and the wall. It was a prophecy of 200 years before it would happen, of a secular king. God would rise up so that God would get that secular king to allow his people to be set free. And you read in Ezra chapter 1 verse 2. "Thus said Cyrus, king of Persia, the Lord God of heaven hath given me the kingdom of the earth and hath challenged me to build the house at Jerusalem." And King Cyrus was given the book of Isaiah and he read it and he found his name in the book and he was blown away by it. And then he set God's people free. And in 539 BC, Cyrus marched in and deposed King Belshazzar of Babylon and set up the Persian Empire. And God's people were set free. I was in a messianic church yesterday morning and a lady got up and she said a prayer and she said, "Do not be worried, be free." And to us, "Do not be worried, be free. Do not be worried, be free. God is over this nation." He's over Europe, is over America, is over secularism. Amen. And God can rise up men and women, even if they do not believe, he can raise them up. He can raise a prime minister up. He can raise a king up. He can raise politicians up. Even if they don't believe in him, people free.
Amen.
That is the God that we believe in.
Amen.
Psalm 115:3, our God is in heaven. He does all that he pleases. Genesis chapter 50, verse 20, as for you, you meant it evil against me, but God meant it for good to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today. Men may have evil against his people, but God can turn it around.
Amen.
Isaiah 40:23, who brings princes to nothing and makes the rulers of the earth as emptiness.
Amen.
And God can take our prime minister and crush him in a minute. God can take our queen if he wanted and crush him in a minute. They are only there because of the power and the glory of God.
Amen.
So we must not fear, though we have these cocky politicians today, ranting and raving at the church, bringing in their immorality, we must not fear them, for we have an awesome God.
Amen.
Isaiah chapter 45, verse 4 and 7. Why will God protect us against the secular realm? One of my favorite films of all time is King Kong. And King Kong's there. And he's got this beautiful woman in a white dress, and she's there, and he's here. And right on one side is a big dinosaur, and on the other side is a dinosaur, and they're about to get her and eat her up, and Kong comes in the middle and bashes them both. Why? Why will God protect us against the secular realm? Because like King Kong, who cared for that lady, God cares for his people. One writer said that all these victories about Cyrus, that all these victories were for the sake of little Israel, is one of the ironies of God's control of history. That little Israel, God was controlling empires for little Israel. God controls this nation for his little people.
Amen.
Isn't that amazing? Amen. The church may seem flabby today. It may seem its coffin is fluttering in the west. But God loves this little church in the western hemisphere. And God is in control of the nations in the western hemisphere and in our nation. And for his people, he will bless them. Cyrus, one great writer, Redpath, said, Cyrus is preferred in order that Israel might be released. Cyrus should have a kingdom, but only in order that God's people may have liberty.
Amen.
He is only in power so that God's people may be set free. Romans 8:28. We know that all those who love God and all things work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose.
Amen.
Even secular nations work to the good of God's people. Proverbs 21:30, no wisdom, no understanding, and no counsel will prevail against the Lord. Daniel chapter 2, verse 21, he changes the times and seasons, he removes kings and establishes kings, he gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding.
Amen.
God blesses his people, God protects his people in the secular realm because he loves his people. Number 3, Isaiah 45, verse 8. God will bless his church in the secular realm.
Amen.
I was listening on TBN, a bishop who was an African bishop, and he was saying the gospel is spreading mightily in Africa and mightily in Asia. And I thought, oh, I wish the same kind of power was in the West and the power was in England of God. Chap a few weeks ago came up to me. I was playing some music on a Sunday morning in Manchester. It was like African gospel. You could dance to it. It was really cool music. And this guy from Nigeria, he came up to me and said, oh, keep doing what you're doing. He said, I'm from Nigeria. Oh, God's really moving. And I've come here to England and I can feel the oppression. Maybe you can feel that oppression in the UK and the West, but it doesn't matter because God's going to bless his people.
Amen.
He's going to bless his people in the West. He's going to bless us in this nation. We'll see fruit in this church. We'll see conversion. We'll see God at work. They ain't going to stop God from doing his work. Isaiah 41:10, so do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And just a little word, if God can do this in a nation that's secular and can move in a nation that's secular, think about what he can do for your life.
Amen.
Don't be discouraged. In your own private life, think about what God can do in a nation and move in a nation. So if you've got your own personal issues, you can deal with them if you can deal with a secular nation.
Amen.
2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8. God is to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, all times, having all you need, you will abound in every good work. Secularism can roar, but our God will bless you and bless us. Let them roar. We have a greater God, and God is with us.
Amen.
Isaiah 45, 9 and 10, the secular realm cannot resist Almighty God. And if you read that passage in Isaiah 9 and 10, there he talks about a potter, and the pot's made. The pot doesn't go to the man who made the pot. Why have you made me? What was the point of making me? You don't answer back. The pot doesn't answer back to the potter. And what Isaiah is saying is, it's futile of people who are secular or who doubt God. How can you doubt God, the one who made you, your creator? And men cannot resist the creator. He created us. And because he created us, he's sovereign over history. And he will do what he wants to do. Romans 8:29. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. They can say whatever they want at the House of Parliament. They can say whatever they want over in Luxembourg. But our God has a plan to save souls, and he will do it whether they want it or not. Nothing can resist the power and the will of God. Isaiah 45 verse 8, God will bless his church, bless us, his church in the secular, forgive me. Number 5, Isaiah 45 verse 11 and 15. God will raise people to help his people. God will raise people to help his people. The Second World War, Hitler came on the scene, and Hitler began to march and take over Europe. But we had silly politicians in England, if you remember. We had Prime Minister at the time who said we should appease Hitler and do whatever he wants us to do. We had politicians who were falling over to please Hitler, and if they'd have got their way, we'd have been a Nazi nation. But God raised up a man called Winston Churchill.
Amen.
And he would not yield one inch to Hitler. And it was because of that one man who would not bow the knee to Hitler that we were set free. But God raised him up. God will raise up people in this land, in any secular land, to defend his people. And Mottier says in the Old Testament, the Creator is not only the one who began everything, but also the one who maintains everything in existence and controls and guides everything. He controls and guides everything, and he controls the politicians, whether they think it or not. Jeremiah 32:27, look, I am Yahweh, the God of all flesh, is anything too difficult for me? Don't mess with God.
Amen.
I said don't mess with God.
Amen.
Politicians are messing with God. Playing with fire. They are building the secular sandcastles and they are playing with fire because our God is over them and our God will hold them to account and our God will bring them down in His time.
Amen.
So don't play around with our God.
Amen.
You have your little happy fest of secularism. Because it will crumble and be gone overnight when our God says so. And it only stands at the moment because God has a purpose and a plan for His people in it.
Amen.
Isn't that amazing?
Amen.
Don't mess with God. Number 7, Isaiah 45, 18 to 21. Number 6. Isaiah 45, 15, 17. When God demonstrates His power over the secular realm, people will be saved. When God demonstrates His power over the secular realm, people will be saved. In Isaiah 45, 15 to 17, receive the words, look unto the end of the earth and be saved. Look unto the end of the earth and be saved. Someone said to me the other day, a blessed brother, I am all for preaching the gospel. I'm not into attacking political correctness. Amen. I'm all for preaching the gospel. This message is about politics in a way. God's over the politicians who are having a field day attacking the church in our land. And God's saying to us today, He's over this, so don't worry about it. But that's not the main thing. He says here, look unto the ends of the earth and be saved. That's what it is all about at the end of the day. Not politics, but salvation. To be saved. Born again. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 14. For our weapons are of our warfare are not flesh, but divinely powerful for the destruction of fortresses. It's in the context of bringing people to salvation. Romans 1, 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, the Jew first, and also to the Greek. God will work in our secular nation, not only politically, but also salvation. He's bringing people to salvation. People will be saved. People will be born again. People will find the living God, even in the darkest of nations. God will bless in salvation. Souls will be saved. People will come here and be saved. The church will see people saved. And God is calling people to be saved. You couldn't get more secular than the Roman Empire. Yet God turned the Roman Empire upside down with 12 ordinary guys and a handful of other people. The Roman Empire was turned upside down by people who were not seen as important. And God used them mightily to save millions in the Roman Empire. And God is doing the same and will do the same in this nation. And in other nations that are secular. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. It's about salvation. This chapter and verse where it says, look unto the ends of the earth and be saved, is, I think Charles Spurgeon was converted through that. As a young boy, he was walking and it was snowing and he went into this Methodist chapel, primitive Methodist, and the preacher didn't turn up. So I think a cop got up and he read these Bible verses And he said, look unto the ends of the earth and be saved. And Spurgeon, as a young man, a young boy, heard those words and he came to know the Lord. God's going to save souls, my friend.
Amen.
And finally, two last points. Isaiah 45, 18 to 21. The foolishness of the secularism and the greatness of God. Here, in these verses, it's talking about not depending on yourself, but depending on God. Nietzsche, the 19th century German philosopher, talked about in the 20th century there will be the death of God. People will stop believing him in the 20th century. And he was an atheist, and he said this. Before it even happened, he said, if they get rid of God, he didn't believe in God. He said, if they get rid of God, there'll only be despair. He said that in the 19th century. The 20th century came. We had wars, world wars, and despair. The 21st century, we have despair. When you throw out God, that's what you get, despair. Jeremiah 29:13, and ye shall seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. If you come to God, you will find not despair, but hope, peace, joy, forgiveness. Secularism can't offer you that. Look at the logic of secularism. Did you realize if you believe there is no God, that a slug is the same value as a baby? If there is no God, a slug is the same value as a baby. That's the absurdity of secularism. But if we seek God, we'll find him. Hebrews 11:6, but without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is the rewarder of him that diligently seek him. We can say to every human being today, if you have faith, you will find God, and God will meet with you, and you'll have a purpose in your life. So it's foolish to reject God. And then finally, Isaiah 45, 22 to 25. God will be glorified by the secular, even by the secular realm. It talks about in this passage, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess his Lord. And it's quoted in Philippians 2, if you remember, chapter 2, verse 10 and 11. Whether people like it or not, they will glorify it. They will have to glorify God one day. No matter what the secularists say or do, one day they'll have to bow the knee before Jesus Christ and give him honor. There was a captain of a ship off the coast of Ireland, and the ship was going down. And the captain said, you're all putting on your life jackets the wrong way. Put your life jacket on the right way. And they wouldn't listen to him. He said, no, we're not listening to you, because they thought he wanted their life jacket. And they wouldn't listen to him. So what did they do? They just put the life jackets on, but they were upside down. Only 10 minutes later, in the water, there's hundreds of people dead, drowned, because they put their life jackets on the wrong way. They didn't listen to the captain. And if secularists do not listen to God, they're not putting their life jacket on the right way, and they will drown under the judgment of God, and they will have to give an account. So make sure we put the life jacket on of Jesus Christ and put it on the right way by believing that he died on the cross for us and gave his life. So we've come to the end of my conclusion. In the 1960s, Chairman Mao, which is very similar to today, is becoming very close like today in England and Europe. Chairman Mao arose and he got everybody to have a little red book and say, you must believe the little red book. And we have today people saying, you must believe in gay rights and identity politics and all this. And they have their little red book of political correctness. In other words, you must believe and follow what we say, or we will judge you as being narrow-minded, Bible-believing bigots. So in the time of Chillamount, they had their little Red Bull, and they said, you better believe this, and they intimidated the Christians. They had what is called the Day of Burning, where they burned all the Bibles in China in the 1960s. Today, what is China like? Still communist. Guess what? There's at least 70 million Christians in China today. It's going to be the most strongest Christian nation in the world soon. You see, secularism can't defeat God. So God's going to bless our nation with conversions, and he's going to raise up people to defend us in this nation. And we mustn't be intimidated by our politicians who keep refusing to follow God and keep trampling under God's word. We must remember that God has got them numbered, and he's working even now for the blessing of his people, for the blessing of his church. And so it is your job to rise up at this time and to take the opportunities that God has given us today. I brought to you from Ireland, do you remember Frank and Kadeem, the Dutch missionaries? They're coming again in March. They sent me Bibles, 60 Bibles, and 190 more Bibles are coming. And they sent me these, Gospel of John, and you can download an app. Now, I brought some here, and my challenge to you today is do not fear secularism. Forget them. You go out and share the gospel. Take a Bible and give it to one of your friends and invite them to church. Why don't you come to church? I challenge you not to fear the culture of the day, but to start spreading the good news in these evil days. So you can take some if you want to take, as many as you want, and pass them on. There's a few here for you. Okay, and if you want some more, I can give you some more, yeah? And the CDs to give to Muslims as well, Journey of Hope. Okay, thank you for listening. God bless you.
Hope God bless to your heart, to your face. Amen. Our God, you the Cyprus for his purpose. Also, our God is using you and I. Amen. Amen. Amen.